So this, in context, is talking about when Jesus Christ is going to be reigning in the millennial reign. And it mentions a lot of the blessings that are going to be taking place. And I want to focus there in verse number 4. The Bible says, "The heart also of the rash shall understand knowledge, and the tongue of the stammerers shall be ready to speak plainly." Now, nothing in the Bible is a coincidence. Things that are put in one verse together, I believe that there is some sort of significance to that. And what's being coupled together here is the heart also of the rash shall understand knowledge. So it's talking about a person that's understanding knowledge. The very next statement says this, "And the tongue of the stammerers shall be ready to speak plainly." And the reason why those two things are coupled together or put together, the person that's understanding knowledge and then also the person that's speaking plainly, is because in order for a person to be able to understand knowledge, they must be learning the knowledge from a person that's speaking plainly. A person that's trying to communicate with someone, and they have a message that they want to convey, and when they speak that message, if it's a confusing message, you know, you're not going to grow in understanding. You're not going to learn anything from that person if they're not speaking plainly. And the title of my sermon is Speaking Plainly. Now here we can see that it's obviously a positive attribute. It's an attribute that God talks about that people are going to have in the millennial reign. That this is considered a blessing. Go ahead and turn to 1 Corinthians chapter number 14. So what does it mean to speak plainly, right? Another way to say that would be to speak clearly. The whole purpose that we speak to one another in the first place is because we want to communicate. If I were to say something to Matt, the whole reason that I opened my mouth to begin with was because I had a message for Matt that I wanted to convey to Matt. Now, obviously, it would be stupid for a person, you know, not to admit that, hey, when I open my mouth, I want to be understood. I want whatever comes out of my mouth and whatever I say, I want it to come out plainly. I want it to come out clearly. Now, like I said, the title of the message is Speaking Plainly. But what I'm going to focus on are negative effects, obviously from a spiritual aspect, negative effects from not speaking plainly. So you're in 1 Corinthians chapter number 14. 1 Corinthians chapter number 14. And this is going to be point number 1, but it's also going to kind of preface the sermon. It's also going to be more of an introduction for the sermon. And the first negative effect is that people are confused, which seems to be the obvious point. Look in 1 Corinthians chapter number 14, verse number 33. It says, "For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints." Now turn to John chapter number 10, verse number 24. So God does not desire us to be confused, and God is not the author of confusion. Therefore, the Bible should not be confusing. Now, it doesn't matter what setting that's in. Obviously, there are things in the Bible that are a little bit more deep than other things, but God still desires you to understand those things. God desires you to understand all things in the Bible. Obviously, there's a limit to what we in our, you know, finite mind are going to be able to learn while we're upon this earth. But that does not negate the fact that God is not the author of confusion, and that God doesn't purposely try to confuse you. Now, there are times, I'm going to talk about that here in a minute, there are times with the unsaved, while Jesus was upon this earth, where He intentionally tried to confuse other people. But that was not Jesus' ministry. Jesus did not just walk around constantly and with the purpose of intending to confuse people. So look at John chapter number 10. We're going to look at a couple of times with Jesus, who is God, who is not the author of confusion, what it's spoken of Jesus, about the way that He speaks. So look in John chapter number 10. I'm in 9. John chapter number 10, verse number 24 says, we'll start verse 22. "And it was at Jerusalem, the feast of the dedication, and it was winter, and Jesus walked in the temple in Solomon's porch. Then came the Jews round about Him and said unto Him, How long dost thou make us to doubt? If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly." Now watch Jesus' response. "Jesus answered them, I told you, and ye believe me not. The works that I do in my Father's name, They bear me witness. So the Jews tried to approach. They tried to confront Jesus and say, hey, they're basically accusing him of not speaking plainly. They're like, how long do you want to make us to doubt? You know, they're accusing him of speaking, you know, and being confusing with whether or not he's claiming to be the Christ or not. And then Jesus Christ responds, and he says in verse number 25, I told you, and ye believe not. They accused him of not speaking plainly. He tells you, I told you. I told you plainly is what he's saying. You know, Jesus Christ didn't walk around upon this earth and speak, you know, an extremely confusing message. Like I said, we're going to look at right now. Go to, we'll first go to John chapter 11, verse 24. Now, there were some parables that Jesus Christ spoke. And he spoke those particular parables for the purpose of the unsaved. He spoke those particular parables, you know, and dark sayings to those that were not saved. Look at John chapter 11, verse number 24. John chapter number 11, verse number 24, it says, Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said unto him, it's verse 14. I'm glad I figured that out just now. Look at verse 9 over in chapter 11. Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not, because he seeth the light of this world. But if a man walk in the night, he stumbleth, because there is no light in him. These things said he, and after that, he saith unto them, O friend Lazarus, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may awake him out of sleep. Then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit, Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking of rest and sleep. Then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. So we have an example here of when Jesus is speaking to his disciples, when they're directly, and it's just his disciples that are with him. And sleeping is a term that's used oftentimes in the Bible. And there are multiple times when it doesn't just come out plainly and tell you just like this, that it means that someone's dead. So it's a term that's used often in the Bible, very often. Like in the book of Thessalonians, it'll talk about those that are asleep in Jesus, right? It's talking about those that are dead. And Jesus uses sleep here, speaking about those that are dead, and then he perceives that they aren't understanding what he's saying. And what's he do to make sure that they understand? He speaks more plain. He speaks plainly. And he says in verse number 14, then said Jesus unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. So while Jesus Christ walked this earth, and he preached to his disciples, and when he was preaching the gospel, Jesus Christ was speaking plainly. Turn to John chapter number 16, verse number 25. John chapter number 16, verse number 25. Now Jesus, even while Jesus was upon this earth, and he did speak sometimes in dark sayings, and he did speak in parables, the disciples didn't go around doing that. His disciples didn't do that, and his disciples were never commissioned to do that. We're told over and over again as Christians and disciples of God to make sure that we speak plainly, that we speak clearly, and that when we speak, we should be understood. Look at John chapter number 16, look at verse number 25. John chapter number 16, verse number 25, he says, these things have I spoken unto you in Proverbs, but the time cometh when I shall no more speak unto you in Proverbs, but I shall show you plainly of the Father. So when he says, but I shall show you plainly of the Father, I believe he's also talking about speaking right there. Because he was just talking about before that, speaking and not being understood. Look what he says in verse number 26. I'll show you why I believe that. At that day ye shall ask in my name, and I say not unto you, that I will pray the Father for you. So notice, this isn't a time when they get to heaven. This is a time while they're still on earth, right? Keep reading. I came forth from heaven, and am come into the world again. I leave the world and go to the Father. His disciples said unto him, lo, now speakest thou plainly, and speakest no proverb. Now are we sure that thou knowest all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee. By this we believe that thou camest from God. So they respond right there, and they say, now you're speaking plainly. Now we understand what you're saying. And us as disciples, we should take God as our example, that He's not the author of confusion.
Amen.
We should take Jesus Christ as our example, who walked around on this earth. And when He preached an offensive message, people didn't walk away and think, wow, I don't know if that was directed at me or not. I'm not really sure if you know that He was talking about me. People knew who He was talking about. People knew what He was talking about. And when Jesus Christ went around and was preaching the gospel, do you know what happened? People got saved.
Amen.
It wasn't a confusing message. It wasn't all this confusion that you see going on today. We need to take God as our example. We need to take Jesus Christ as our example. We need to take the plain words of the Bible, of the Holy Spirit as our example. And as Christians, you should live your everyday life speaking plainly. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter number 3, verse number 12. 2 Corinthians chapter number 3, verse number 12. Like I said, the first negative effect of not speaking plainly is that people are confused. That's the obvious one. But the second, and I have two major points in this sermon. The second negative effect of going around and not speaking plainly is that people die and they go to hell. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter number 3, verse number 12. It says, seeing then that we have such hope. So when he says such hope, he's talking about the hope that he just explained. He just got done explaining how glorious the New Testament is compared to the Old Testament. How great and how glorious it is. He said, seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. So there again, he's comparing the Old Testament to the New Testament. And he said, seeing then that we have such hope. Talk about the New Testament. When you get saved and you really understand the gospel, it's a great thing. It really, truly is good news.
Amen.
And you're like, man, you know, I was super excited about it. I remember when I got saved and I was 11 years old, I was super excited that I was saved and that I knew that I was going to heaven. Because it's good news. It's not good news if we had to work our way to heaven. If you had to, you know, be a good person, if you had to keep all the commandments, no one would be going. That's not good news. The good news is that Jesus Christ paid for everything for us.
Amen.
And that all that you have to do is just place your trust in Him. It's great that He uses the example in the Bible of just a child. Because that just shows how easy it is to get to heaven. And that's how simple the gospel is. Now I'm going to go ahead and have you turn to another passage real quick. 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. But keep in mind now, this is another person as our example. This is Paul, who says, seeing then that we have such hope, the hope that we have, he says, we use great plainness of speech. Now, the fact that we have, what difference would it make if we had the greatest hope in the world like we have, but you went around every day and you preached a confusing message? You went around with the greatest hope in the world, the gospel, the good news. You know, so simple that literally even a child can believe in it. But you go door to door and you preach a confusing message. Now, there's multiple reasons that this could be going on. Multiple reasons. One of them, you know, like a lot of churches, we don't have this problem, but a lot of churches have the problem of being scared of talking about hell. That's not something, you know, we struggle with. But a lot of churches, you know, they kind of want to skip over that. They kind of want to, you know, kind of jump past that part. You know, maybe they leave parts out on that. You know, but that could be a reason why someone's confusing the gospel. Because they're not understanding. Because before you understand you need to be saved, or before you understand you need a Savior, you have to understand that you need to be saved.
Yeah.
That you're damned. That you're condemned. So before you believe and trust in Jesus, you have to know, why am I trusting Jesus? Why do I need Jesus? That's why it's so important to understand that, hey, I need to be saved. I'm condemned. And when you go door to door, your gospel should not be complex. It should not be, you know, a complex gospel where you just use all these new verses. Where did I have you turn? 1 Corinthians chapter 2?
Yeah.
So look again at 1 Corinthians chapter 2. So it's Paul speaking. 1 Corinthians chapter number 2. Look at verse number 1. He says, and I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you, save Jesus Christ and him crucified. So we have Paul the Apostle again, the greatest, probably the greatest Christian that ever lived, considered by many, many Christians at least, the greatest Christian, definitely the greatest of the 12 apostles. And he says, when he went to Corinth, he says, I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. So he made sure that, hey, when I go to these people's door, when I speak to them for the very first time, I'm going to make sure that the only thing that I talk about so that I don't confuse them is Jesus Christ. Because that's all that you'll do. If you go to an unsaved person's door and you start bringing up all these other subjects, you know, all these other, you know, you go down these rabbit trails, they keep asking you questions, and you just answer every single question, you know, that this guy's been watching YouTube videos all the time, you gotta answer every question for him. You know what you're gonna do to the guy? You're gonna confuse him. You're gonna confuse him. You're not gonna make it better, like, oh, I'm just gonna resolve every problem for this person. No. What you're doing is you're going back and forth to the gospel, and his mind's not really on the gospel. And the gospel should be simple. The gospel should be the focus when you go to someone's door. That should be what you're focusing on. So one of the reasons why people go to hell, because as a negative effect of not speaking plainly, is because people aren't teaching that we deserve to go to hell, that mankind deserves hell. Another reason, like I just said here, excuse me, is because people jump around. They go from one thing to another. They're not focusing on the gospel, you know, Jesus Christ and him crucified, like Paul says here. And here's another thing, and this really super badly irritates me, you know, when people do this. And I've been out with people tons of times. When people, like, want to have their own gospel, and they're, like, going to the book of Leviticus, and they're going to the book of Hebrews, and they're, like, going to, like, all these cryptic passages. And the reason why it makes me really, really mad, two reasons. Number one, the reason why it makes me super, super mad is because the only reason why you do that is because you're trying to be prideful. Right. Like, you want to try to say, hey, my gospel's better than everybody else's gospel. That's why people choose that. They want to try to make their gospel different because everybody else's gospel is not good enough. They try to separate their gospel from everybody else's gospel. Let me explain this to you. This is not a game. People are going to hell. And you don't just come up with your cute little gospel and go around and send people to hell because you want to be different or because you want to be cool. And that's the second reason why it makes me mad. Going soul winning is not a game. There are people dying and they're going to hell. So, and here's another thing. If you're not ready to be a soul winner, like if you still need to be a silent partner, then be a silent partner. There's nothing wrong with that. You know what you need to do? You need to go home and you need to study the gospel more.
Amen.
You need to go over it over and over and over again. Because if you're not ready, then don't go to someone's door and give them a confusing message and then I have to go back later and spend 30, 45, 50 minutes with this person and waste my time because you preached a confusing message.
Yep.
When I could be knocking more doors and getting more people saved. It's not only my time, it's all the other people out there that are using great plainness of speech. So don't try, you know, if you're a brand new, and we go to these soul winning marathons all the time, and so many people are not ready to go soul winning, but they just want to say, hey, I'm ready to go soul winning. They meet, you know, the people from Faithful Word, and they don't want to say, hey, I'm new. It's all right to be new.
Yep.
You know what's not all right is to be new and lie about it and say, hey, I've been going soul winning with my church, and then get out there and preach a confusing message, and then you send a family to hell of five people that you get the opportunity to sit down with them, and you preach a confusing message. It's not great plainness of speech. Because we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. Keep that in mind, that when you got saved, how good of news that was. That good news, that when you got saved and how happy you were, that should provoke you to, hey, I want to make sure I don't give a confusing message to anybody else. I don't want to make sure that it's my fault that somebody else missed out on understanding the gospel. There's nothing wrong with being new. The problem comes in when you're new, and then you try to get out there and say, hey, I'm ready, and then you're not ready.
Yeah.
Or the problem comes in when you've been soul winning for a year, and you just don't want to do it the way that everybody else does it. And then you go out there and you preach this weird thing, and I've heard all kinds of weird examples where people are, you know, I heard Pastor Anderson one time, this is the worst, obviously, where people are like in their gospel going to Romans 1 and like preaching about a reprobate. It's like, what in the world does that have to do with going to heaven?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, people just need to stick to the gospel. Just like Paul said, I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. When you go to someone's door, Make sure that you're using great plainness of speech, because what, imagine, I want you to think about this in your mind for a minute. Imagine if you were able to see the people specifically, which is very possible this will happen, the people that you went to their door and you weren't ready to give the gospel, and you gave a confusing message, you didn't use great plainness of speech, and you were able to actually see those people who went to hell. And you knew, like, that was my fault. That person would have went to heaven if I would have given a great, if I would have used great plainness of speech. If I would have waited and then went back later. Because here's the thing, you know, giving the gospel is even, you know why it's so easy to get a child saved? Because they're not brainwashed. Mm-hmm. That's the reason why. You know, when I got saved personally, I was 11 years old, and I grew up in an IFB church, so I'd heard the right preaching and everything. But it's way different when somebody finally takes you aside, and then they preach the gospel to you, it all of a sudden clicks. Yeah. And you know, when they preached me the gospel, just like most IFBs, they didn't like focus on eternal security. But I understood eternal security. And the reason why I understood eternal security was because they kept using the word saved. That's past tense. The reason why I understood eternal security was because the guy focused really hardcore on it's only by believing. It's only by believing. Once you believe, you're saved. And it's not by our works at all. It's not by our works. Nothing we do, you know, nothing we do can earn our salvation. So I understood as an 11-year-old kid, once I believe, that's all that needs to be done. Therefore, I'm saved. At 11 years old. That's why it's so easy to get a child saved, because they haven't already been conditioned that you can lose your salvation. Mm-hmm. So, in an age of major confusion, in a time of all of this false Christianity and a lot of people, you know, Jehovah's Witnesses and all these other denominations of so-called Christianity, while they're going out preaching a confusing message, how much worse would it be if you, who have the truth, who have such hope, go out and then you also don't use great plainness of speech?
Yeah.
You just add to the confusion. You know, you need to make sure that you're ready to go soul winning. You need to make sure, like, hey, I understand it. I can, you know, and if you're, and it's not even a big deal if, you know, hey, I'm going to try it. I feel like I'm ready. And then you're not. Just make sure you let your partner take over. Make sure that they can kind of clear up. And they can use great plainness of speech. And they can make sure that everybody understands. Whoever it is being preached to.
Yeah.
You know? Because this is not a game. When you start doing things all the time, you become complacent.
Uh-huh.
It's not a game. People are dying and burning in hell. Imagine if it was you. See, that's different all of a sudden when you think about it that way. You know, people are not games. You know, this is about people's eternal destiny. It's about where they're going to spend, you know, forever and ever and ever. Keep that in your mind. Make sure that you're not just going that you're not just going through the routine. Even seasoned soul winners. Make sure when you go to the door that you're taking your time, that you're being thorough. You know, obviously you can be over thorough, but make sure you're being thorough and make sure that you're using great plainness of speech. Make sure that you're understood. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 6, verse 19. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 19. So we saw Jesus was speaking plainly. We saw God's not the author of confusion. We saw even the Jews tried to accuse Jesus of not speaking plainly. And he's like, I told you. He spoke plainly. He told them, I'm the Christ, right? Mm-hmm. Then we saw Paul two times. He said, hey, seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. Talking about, you know, our salvation, the New Testament. And then he said when he came to the Corinthians originally, he wrote in the first letter to Corinthians, he said that in chapter 2, he said that when I came unto you, I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified, right? So we have all these examples. Paul was a seasoned Christian, right? He still even said that. He even still kept that in his mind. And look at this right here, Paul. Look at Ephesians chapter number 6. Let's read down through here. We'll start in verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. So he says to the Christians at Ephesus, he said, these are the things that you need to take for you. Now watch what he says in verse 19. And for me, saying, praying for me. That was the application from the last verse. He said in the first two words in verse 18, praying always. So in verse 19, he's saying, and for me, saying, pray for me. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. Now, even though, this is the point that I want to make from this verse, even though the gospel is very, very simple, it's still a mystery. And it still needs a Christian to go to someone's door and to explain it.
Amen.
You need to take your time and you need to make sure that you're speaking plainly and that you're not delivering a confusing message, because people's souls are at hand, right? People's souls are at stake, right? Of course, but also because it's a mystery. And when you have other people confusing it already, the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Mormons, the Pentecostals, all these people confusing the message already, you even more so need to make sure that you're taking your time and that you're speaking plainly, right? Look at another passage, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, read verse 1. Would to God ye could bear with me a little in my folly, and indeed bear with me, for I am jealous over you with godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. And then he says in verse 3, but I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. So over and over again, we see it referred to as something simple, right? It's not something complex. So when you give the gospel, there should be no reason why your gospel is complex. Mm-hmm. If the Bible tells you, hey, the gospel's not complex, and then when you're preaching the gospel and your gospel's complex, there's a problem.
Amen.
That's not right. You know, there's simplicity in Christ. It's easy. A child can understand it. So you need to make sure, and preaching the gospel to a child gives you a lot of practice, especially in the beginning, because there's a lot of things when you're preaching the gospel to a child that kind of like have to happen concurrently at the same time. You have to make sure while you're preaching the gospel to a child that you're very, very clear. Their vocabulary is not as wide, right? So you have to use great plainness of speech. And what does the word plain mean? It means like bare. It means like it's like raw. It means like there's not a lot there. It means simple, right? It means it's not complex. If I said that's plain and then you looked at it and you thought in your mind like, that's complex, that's not the same thing, right? We weren't looking at the same thing, obviously. Plain is the opposite of complex. And when you preach the gospel to a child, you have to make sure that you use great plainness of speech. It has to be very easy to understand. Like I said, their vocabulary is not as wide as an adult's vocabulary, right? But also, you have to make sure that you're being, you know, you obviously always have to be thorough, but you also have to make sure while using great plainness of speech, that you're being concise with a child. Mm-hmm. That you're not, you know, because anybody could preach the gospel to a child if they, you know, if they had 3 hours to do it. But if it took 3 hours to explain the gospel to a child, do you think they're going to understand it when you walk away?
No.
Not a chance. They're distracted, you know, they jumble all that information together. You have to make sure that you're concise, but you're also using great plainness of speech. Children are distracted easily. Children are confused easily. And if you have to contradict yourself 4 times before you get the right statement out, the one statement that was clear, then the child's going to be confused. So a child is very good practice to make sure that you're using great plainness of speech. Go to Deuteronomy chapter number 27, verse number 8. So the first point, the first negative effect which applies to both of my next points, which is pretty obvious. The first negative effect of not speaking plainly or not speaking clearly is that people, the result is people are confused. People will be confused at whatever's going on, right? Then my second point of a negative impact that it has on people when you don't speak plainly or you don't use great plainness of speech is that people will die and go to hell. Now look here at Deuteronomy chapter number 27. Deuteronomy chapter number 27. And we'll start reading in verse number 1 to get the context. This is after the law had been given to Moses. It says in Deuteronomy chapter number 27, verse number 1. And Moses with the elders of Israel commanded the people, saying, keep all the commandments which I command you this day. And it shall be on the day when ye shall pass over Jordan unto the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, that thou shalt set thee up great stones, and plaister them with plaister, and thou shalt write upon them all the words of this law when thou art passed over, that thou mayest go in unto the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. So he's telling them to set up the stones right with the law. A land that floweth with milk and honey, as the Lord God of thy fathers hath promised thee. Therefore it shall be, when ye be gone over Jordan, that ye shall set up these stones, which I command you this day, in Mount Ebal. And thou shalt plaister them with plaister, and there shalt thou build an altar unto the Lord thy God, an altar of stones. Thou shalt not lift up any iron tool upon them. Thou shalt build the altar of the Lord thy God of whole stones. And thou shalt offer burnt offerings thereon unto the Lord thy God. And thou shalt offer peace offerings and shalt eat there and rejoice before the Lord thy God. Verse 8 is what I want to focus on. And thou shalt write upon the stones all the words of this law. And then watch what he says. Very plainly. That's like exactly that same statement that we read in the New Testament where it said, great plainness of speech. Very plainly. So he gives all these commands. He's saying, hey, you're going to go into the land of Canaan. You know, you're going to possess the land filled with milk and honey, right? And when you get into this land, here's the instructions. I want you to build an altar, right? I don't want you to use, you know, I want you to use whole stones. I don't want you to, you know, carve the stones out or shape the stones in any particular way. Just use whole stones, right? And that represents the fact that our salvation is not of our own works. We just take what God gave us, right? Now, here in the end, he says in verse 8, when you write the law upon these particular stones that I want you to set up, he doesn't just say, hey, write the law on these stones. He gives specific instructions at the very end. And he says, the stones, write upon the stones, all, number one, that's the first thing I want you to notice, all the words of this law. And then he says this, very plainly. So it wasn't enough for God just to tell them, hey, write the law on these stones. There's two things in there that are very important. He wants to make sure that you write all the law, right? Just like Jesus Christ said that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. I've quoted that tons of times. It just slipped my brain. Yeah, so notice he says every word, right? You have to make sure you have every word. Just to have half the law was not good enough. Just to have part of the law was not good enough. You know what you have across the country? And I'm not even referring to... I could give a rip. I don't care at all what these Presbyterians and these Pentecostals and Jehovah's Witnesses are doing. But you know what you have across the United States and across the entire world? You have saved believers. You have, you know, independent, fundamental Baptists, pastors who are getting up behind the pulpit. And you know what they're not doing? Two things. They're not preaching all the law. They're not preaching every bit of the law. When it says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word. You know what they're preaching? They're preaching what they feel like preaching. That's what they're preaching. Yeah. They're preaching because they got, you know, their deacon sitting over here, you know, and watching every single word that they say. And they know that if something slips out of my mouth that's not right, or something comes out, if I actually start preaching the Bible, you know, I'm going to lose my job. You know, I'm not going to be able to work for the church anymore. I'm going to have to go find somewhere else. That's the reason. That's the real reason why they're not preaching all the Bible. You know, with other stuff aside, maybe that they're not filled with the Holy Ghost. Maybe that has something to do with it. Maybe it's because they're not reading all the Bible when they're by themselves. Because all these pastors, some of the stupid stuff that comes out of their mouth, maybe, well, I just had an epiphany. Maybe there's two reasons why. Maybe it's because they're so badly trying to avoid preaching other things. Maybe that's why they're saying all this dumb stuff. Number one, or maybe number two, it's just because they're too scared. And here's the thing. Go to Ezekiel 33. It's wasn't in my sermon, but we're going to turn here. Go to Ezekiel chapter number 33. All of these pastors that get up behind the pulpit, you know, these guys, they real flippantly just say one day, hey, you know, God's calling me to preach and I'm going to become a pastor. I'm going to get up behind the pulpit and I'm just going to preach. It can't be that hard. It can't be that hard just to, you know, preach the Bible. When they don't understand what responsibility that they're taking upon their hands at that moment. When they get up behind that pulpit. Look at Ezekiel chapter number 33. we'll start verse number 1. Again, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, speak to the children of thy people, and say unto them, when I bring the sword upon a land, if the people of the land take a man of their coast, and set him for their watchman, that's the pastor that's deciding, hey, I want to be a pastor. I'm going to get up behind the pulpit and preach. Look at verse number 3. If when he seeth the sword come upon the land, that's him when he sits down and he reads the Bible. And he sees all these commands, like thou shalt not commit adultery. You know, like all the warnings that Jesus Christ gave, that if a man takes a woman that's put away, that he commits adultery. That's what this is when he sees the sword come. Look at the next part. If when he seeth the sword come upon the land, he blow the trumpet and warn the people, that would be him preaching God's word. Look at verse 4. Then whosoever heareth the sound of the trumpet and taketh not warning, if the sword come and take him away, his blood shall be upon his own head. He heard the sound of the trumpet and took not warning. His blood shall be upon him, but he that taketh warning shall deliver his soul. But if the watchman see the sword come and blow not the trumpet, and the people be not warned, if the sword come and take any person from among them, he is taken away in his iniquity. Watch this. But his blood will I require at the watchman's hands. When you stand up behind a pulpit to preach, and especially if you're the pastor of the church, like it's your job to be guiding the flock. It's your job to be pastoring and teaching the people the Bible that are seated, you know, in the pews, that are seated in the folding chairs. You know, you better make sure that you're preaching all the Bible. You better make sure that you're not just leaving things out just because you feel like it. That you're not going to blow the trumpet just because, hey, I don't feel like it today. It's not my day. I don't feel like preaching on that because it's negative. Mm-hmm. You know, you better understand what responsibility you're taking. You'd be a lot better off, buddy, if you just sit your butt down in the pew and you'd let somebody else get up there and preach God's word. That would be better not only for you, not only for the people that are hearing the preaching, but it'd be a lot better for you. Because people just decide real flippantly today, hey, my dad was a preacher, his dad was a preacher, I'm going to be a preacher. You better be real careful. You better know and you better have your mind made up. If you're going to be a preacher, if you're going to be a pastor of a church, hey, I'm willing to preach the whole Bible, even if my entire congregation turns on me. Yeah. You have to envision the worst scenarios. You have to understand, no matter what happens, I'm going to make sure that I preach the whole Bible. Yep. I'm going to preach whatever God said. And not only the whole Bible, not only like God said, all this law. Turn to 1 Corinthians again, where we were before. Not only do you have to preach all the law, but you have to preach it very plainly. You have to make sure that you're understood. There should be no reason why people are walking out of church like they do so often. And they're like, what does my pastor believe about that? He just dedicated an entire sermon to when the rapture takes place, and I don't have a clue what he believes. You know why? Because he's, and here's the thing. They're not accidentally, you know, it's not that they just don't have good communication skills. That's not the problem. It's not that they're just, you know, they're not able to convey a message to you, hey, this is what I believe. It's because they don't want you to understand. Mm-hmm. Because they don't want to basically, because the Bible's a sharp two-edged sword. And the Bible divides, hey, right here. Here's the rapture. This is when the rapture takes place. Here's the tribulation. Here's the wrath. The Bible's clear. but they don't want to use the Bible to make their divisions. They want to preach purposely a confusing message. Now, we're going to have you turn 1 Corinthians 14. That's where we were before. Now, notice what it talks about right here. Whoops. Notice what it talks about right here. Very similar to what we were reading when it talked about him blowing the trumpet. Why it's setting a watchman and the watchman blowing the trumpet. We didn't read this part earlier. We read in verse 33. Let's start reading in verse 6. He says, "Now, brethren..." But let's get verse 5. Let's get the context of verse 5 that he's speaking of prophesying. Watch what he says. "I would that ye all spake with tongues, but rather that ye prophesied," right? "For greater is he that prophesieth than he would speak than he that speaketh with tongues." So the context he's speaking about is preaching God's word, right? Look at verse 6. "Now, brethren, if I come unto you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you, except I shall speak to you either by revelation, or by knowledge, or by prophesying, or by doctrine? And even things with life-giving sound, whether pipe or harp, except they give a distinction in the sounds, how shall it be known what is piped or harped? For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to battle?" Now we saw over in Ezekiel chapter number 33, it was talking about if the city sets a watchman, and he agrees to be the watchman, right? And he sees the sword come. If he doesn't blow his trumpet, then that person, obviously, they're going to die. But their blood also is going to be required at the watchman's hand.
Yep.
Now that's not the only scenario when the watchman could be held responsible. And this right here tells us another scenario. It gives us another situation. And that's if the person says, "Hey, I'm going to be a watchman. I'm going to be the pastor. I'm going to be the preacher." They get up behind the pulpit, and then they just blow the trumpet with an uncertain sound, where the people aren't sure whether it's a battle or not. And notice it says, "How shall he prepare himself to battle?" Because here's the thing. Just like I said earlier, knocking on doors and getting people saved, you know, that's not a joke. Giving the gospel to people, that's not a joke. People are dying and going to hell. You know what else isn't a joke? The Christian life in general.
Yep.
It's a battle. Like we read in Ephesians chapter 6. So flippantly, like I said a couple of times, these pastors say, "Hey, I'm going to get behind the pulpit." They don't realize, hey, you're a watchman in a real battle. There's a real battle going on, buddy. And hey, and there's a bunch of new churches now that are actually ready to go fight in a real battle.
Yeah.
Not these little kiddie wars that have been fought for the past 30, 40 years. And here's the thing. If all these pastors, you know, they got a lot of the people in their congregation who actually want to understand the Bible. And who actually want to, hey, I want to know the Bible. And they walk out confused and they don't know really what they believe either. You know, the Bible talks about that my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge, right? And here, what does Paul say? He says, if I come and speak to you, talking about preaching, he says, by revelation or by knowledge, right? So the pastor is supposed to be preaching knowledge. People should be learning. Now, here's the thing also. This is what you have to also keep in mind. You're still responsible to read the Bible and understand the Bible.
Yeah.
Just like when the sword came, and, you know, that person was still killed, they were still responsible for themselves, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then also, the pastor is also responsible. The blood's on his hands as well. So it doesn't give you, it doesn't just negate everything for the person sitting in the pew, the person that's listening to the preacher. They need to be reading their Bible as well. But it's sad that there are people out there, you know, that do read some of their Bible at least. I'm sure there's plenty of examples across the entire country. I'm sure there's tons of examples who are reading their Bible. And maybe they start to understand the truth. And this is a similar situation that I fell into for many years. They start to understand the truth, but then the preaching's like contradicting what they're reading. Like the truths in the Bible. They're contradicting what they're reading. And I was a new Christian and I was sincere. You know, I maybe read my Bible like 4 or 5 times. And I started, you know, seeing like, hey, you know, what I was reading was not dispensationalism. Let me put it that way. I didn't believe in any sort of hyper-dispensationalism, any sort of dispensationalism. But when I went to church, I heard dispensationalism preached. And I real humbly, you know, and I treated my pastor as a father, and I went to him and I told him, hey, you know, what you're preaching just doesn't feel like maybe it's me. I was serious. Like, I wasn't going to him to challenge him. I had a desire to understand the Bible. And I believe there's tons of people like that really have a sincere, that are being guided. You know, the Holy Ghost is guiding them and teaching them the truth.
Yeah.
But then the pastor's standing up and he's not using great plainness of speech. And I went to my pastor and I told him, hey, it's not really what I'm seeing. And he told me his point of view. You know, it was a civil conversation. And then after the conversation, I walked away and I thought to myself this thought. I remember like almost like as it's words in my mind. I thought to myself this thought. I've been saved since I was 11. I just got baptized 2 years ago. And I've read my Bible 5 times. My pastor's been saved for like 30 years, 20, 30 years. And he's read his Bible like 60 times. Why would I think that I'm right? And I just walked away with that mindset. I kept reading the Bible. I actually, coincidentally, I stumbled upon Pastor Anderson literally about 3 weeks after that. And everything, all the interpretations that were opposite of hyper-dispensationalism, that was what Pastor Anderson taught. And I don't believe that that's an accident. I believe that, that's because God knew that I was sincere and I had a true desire to understand God's Word. And I was about ready to go down the path that He was teaching me to go down. I was just going to say, hey, you know, I'm a new Christian, and I believe to an extent that that's the right attitude. That's a humble attitude. That's a sincere attitude. You know, obviously, something worse would be just to go in and just, you know, not believe anything your pastor tells you. Because I learned a lot of truths from him, but there was a lot of false things that were taught too. You know, and there's a lot of people that are getting a confusing message. Sincere people that are reading the Bible, and they're being confused. And that's because the pastors aren't, you know, using great plainness of speech. Now, besides not learning knowledge and not growing in the knowledge of the Bible and not growing just in wisdom, you know what else? You know what else goes on? People end up destroying their lives. People end up not knowing, you know, and obviously it's their fault too. But if it could be saved by the watchman, if the watchman could stand up behind the pulpit and say, you know, he that marries her that's put away commits adultery, then somebody could understand, hey, that's not a good choice for me to do. Maybe they didn't read their own Bible, but at least the watchman standing behind the pulpit could tell them, hey, you know, this is adultery and this is not. This is, you know, the grounds for marriage. This is how it works. And they could have all these things explained to them. You know, and that's the watchman's job. Yeah. The watchman's job is to look over, you know, everyone at his congregation. It's to guide, you know, guide the flock, to lead the flock. He's supposed to be the under-shepherd. He's supposed to, and here's the thing. If the law is supposed to be written very plainly, it's kind of like what I said before. If the gospel's simple and you're preaching a complex message, you're not preaching the gospel. Yeah. If the law is supposed to be written very plainly, if it's written in great plainness of speech, and a pastor gets up behind the pulpit and what he's saying is not plain, then he's not preaching the Bible.
Yeah.
That's not what's coming across the pulpit. And you know, you could say, here, turn to Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 2. I'm going to read you from 1 Samuel real quick. I'll read you from 1 Samuel chapter number 10. We'll have an example of a prophet and how a prophet speaks, referring to Samuel specifically. 1 Samuel chapter number 10, after Saul's asses were gone, and he returns back home, he tells them about when he spake with Samuel. And he says in verse 14, and Saul's uncle said unto him and to his servant, whither went ye? And he said, to seek the asses. And when we saw that they were nowhere, we came to Samuel. And Saul's uncle said, tell me, I pray thee, what Samuel said unto you. And watch what he says. And Saul said unto his uncle, he told us plainly that the asses were found. And that's how a prophet should speak. That's how a man of God, a preacher, should speak. He should speak plainly. Now you're in, where did you go? Habakkuk chapter number 2?
Yeah.
Thank you. Whoops. In the world, did somebody pull Habakkuk out of my Bible? Habakkuk. There we go. Hey, Habakkuk chapter number 2, verse number 2. I'm going to go through like 6 of these. Habakkuk chapter number 2. Look at verse number 1 first. I will stand upon my watch and set me upon the tower and will watch to see what he will say unto me and what I shall answer when I am reproved. So notice, he's going to stand upon the tower, right? He's the watchman. Now watch what it says in verse 2. And the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tables that he may run that readeth it. Now, I want you to turn to Matthew chapter number 24, verse number 15. Matthew chapter number 24, verse number 15. I believe that that had an immediate application, but I believe that that was definitely a prophecy that's also quoted in the New Testament. Matthew chapter number 24, we'll read, we'll just read verse number 15. We'll just read right there in verse number 15. So it says, "When ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place." Now watch what it says in parentheses. "Whoso readeth, let him understand." Now when you skip down, we'll just keep reading down through here. "Then let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains." So notice the very next statement. Just like in Habakkuk chapter number 2, verse number 2, you have the watchman standing on the tower, and then God gives the vision, right? And he says he wants to make it plain. And what's the reason why he wants to make it plain? So that those that read it can understand. So that those that, you know, the vision is preached to them, that they can understand. And here's the thing. All these the pastors that know that it's not pre-trib, and they keep preaching, they keep preaching a pre-tribulational rapture, when they've had the truth presented to them, and they understand it. I'll give mercy and say some of them are just so sucked into what they believe, and they're just totally retarded, and they just can't understand that it's clearly after the tribulation for some of them. But there's a lot of these pastors out there who have been presented with the true, end times Bible prophecy that the rapture clearly comes after the tribulation, and they still understand. They still preach the pre-tribulational rapture. Mm-hmm. Do you know what's going to happen? I firmly and 100% believe that they are going to be held responsible for the people that die. Yeah. That they preach to. Because here, maybe this hasn't run through your mind yet, but the people that really believe in a pre-trib rapture, they're not prepared to go through tribulation.
Nope.
They're not ready mentally. They're not ready spiritually. And do you know what's going to happen to those people when all of a sudden it starts going on? Because even once the tribulation starts, I don't believe that everybody's going to figure it out. I think once, obviously, the Antichrist comes out.
Yeah.
But there'll still be people that are making excuses. Well, we know that it's pre-trib. That can't be the Antichrist because I already know that it's pre-trib, right? And they'll just keep making excuses and keep making excuses until it's too late and they're carted off to jail and then their head's taken off. That's what'll happen. And they have their pastor up behind the pulpit and he knows that it's after the tribulation. And he just keeps preaching the pre-trib rapture. You know what God said? "I wrote this so that whosoever readeth that he would understand." God said that it was written very plainly. That whosoever saw the vision, right, that they would understand it. Now imagine how mad that would make God when God says, "Hey, I have a message to give to these people, which is a warning that these people could die. You know what? It's time to run. Right now, you need to run, right? Those that be in the mountains, it's time to flee." And then the pastor, a saved man, stands up behind the pulpit, supposedly preaching God's word, and he's like, "You got nothing to worry about. You don't need to run." Imagine how angry, how mad if you were, in a similar situation in God's stance, how mad would it make you if you loved and cared about the people that he's deceiving?
Yeah.
How mad do you think it makes him when he says, "Whosoever reads, that he may understand"? God doesn't want you to be confused. This is where the sermon kind of takes full circle. God doesn't want people to be confused. God doesn't want you to be confused. So you say, "Hey, I'm not going to be a pastor. I'm not going to be a pastor. I don't have any desire, so I don't have to really worry about, preaching behind a pulpit." Yeah, but you're the person that sits in the pew. So you know what you could do? You need to make sure that you, number one, that you're reading your Bible. Amen. That you're sound in the truth on your own. Because you're still going to die if you're not prepared. Mm-hmm. The watchman's responsible, but remember what happened to the man, right? But also, you need to make sure that you don't fall into one of these churches that's preaching a super confusing message. That's not the kind of church that you're going to, right? That's number one. Number two, you should be a soul winner. Everybody here should be going out and knocking on doors and preaching the gospel, right?
Amen.
And you shouldn't be preaching a confusing message. You need to be using great plainness of speech. Why? Because we have such hope. so great a hope, and imagine it just being wasted. Imagine someone not obtaining that hope because your message that you preach is not clear. Right? God has warnings in the Bible. And that's why it's so important to make sure that we use great plainness of speech. You know what one of the warnings is? One of the warnings is that, you know, he doesn't want people to go to hell. That you're going to hell. But hey, here's the hope. Right? We need to, you know, convey that message with great plainness of speech. We need to speak plainly. We need to make sure that we're speaking clearly and that we're understood. And pastors, if you want to be a pastor, you know what you need to start working on now? Is being articulate, being apt to teach. That's something you need. You need to be able to speak plainly. You need to be able to speak clearly where you're understood. Mm-hmm. If that's a desire that you have. If you don't want to be a pastor, that's fine. You need to be a soul winner still. So you at least need to have some degree or some level of, you know, of being apt to teach. Of being speaking clearly. You still need to have some, you know, level of speaking clearly. You need to be preaching the gospel clearly, boldly, plainly, right? Also, if you're not going to be a pastor, like I said a moment ago, you need to make sure that you're reading your Bible on your own, because these warnings, everything's still going to take place either way. So don't you want to be prepared?
Amen.
Don't you want to understand? The Bible's written plainly, so even if your pastor's preaching a confusing message, you know, get in here and dig things out that maybe you're confused about, because this is plain. God's plain, right?
Amen.
The Bible talks about, you know, speaking as of the oracles of God. You know what that means? Speaking plainly. Right? That'd be an aspect to it. God speaks plainly. God's not the author of confusion. We don't need to be walking around in our everyday lives preaching confusing messages. We need to understand what we believe. We need to be able to stand up for what we believe and tell people what we believe. And we need to be able to say it with great plainness of speech, right? Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for all the people that showed up this morning, dear Lord. We thank you that your word is clear, dear Heavenly Father, and that you desire to warn us and that you love us, dear Father. Help us not to be deceived by weak pastors that aren't, you know, willing to preach the truth plainly and to where it's, you know, it's understandable. Dear Lord God, we ask you just to be with us and bless us and just guide us into your truth. Dear Heavenly Father, even if somebody does try to confuse us or deceive us, we love you. Just be with us the rest of the day. Bless the services. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
Amen.